Thank you, Dr. Bhagavathiran, for a wonderful lecture. Now we move on to the next topic, that is robotics, future surgery by Dr. N. Raghavan. With short CV, he finished his MBBS from Ramchandra Medical College and MS from PGI Chandigarh and MD from Lancashire University and FRCS from Edinburgh. He is a consultant neuro-oncologist at Incubator and is now working in Apollo for the past almost about 6 years from 2013. He done pioneering work in robotics, one of the first in India to do innovative robotics surgeries and innovative procedures in the role, like robotic IV thrombectomy. With a short CV, I welcome Dr. Raghavan. Please come and take the podium.
For inviting me to this place for this talk. I see so few familiar faces to me. Nice to meet all of you as well. I live in the south part of the world, so it's nice to come to the west part of the world as well. Today, the majority of my work is on robotics. Robotic neuro-oncology is my bulk of my work. And hence, obviously, the talk is going to be on that as well. I'm sure many of you are familiar with robotics in surgery. This is very different than the robotic spine that the orthopedic surgeons use. Here, we use robotics to literally do the surgery itself. I'm just going to quickly run past. All of you are medical colleagues, so I don't need to dwell a lot. So I'll just be very quickly going through this. So we have been traditionally doing surgery from Sushruta period by knife, scalpel, cut open, big surgeon make big incisions, sort of those things. And even in urology, when I started urology, I was doing donor nephrectomy and radical nephrectomy with these loin incisions, breaking a few of the ribs and taking them away. And then open radical prostatectomy, I started doing it when I was in 2002 onwards. In England. So things were done in a very, very large incisions and a lot of recovery time for the patients. Then we started having laparoscopy coming into urology. Kowalski was one of the pioneers who drove laparoscopy in urology. He did the nephrectomy, and from there onwards, literally he copied from the cholecystectomy. He said, oh, the gallbladder is there, you guys are taking gallbladder, let me take the kidney off as well. That's how it started. And then subsequently we understood that using laparoscopy was a good change from a patient's recovery point of view. But when the patient was benefiting, the surgeons were dying like a fly. 3-4 hours of laparoscopic radical prostatectomy almost definitely takes some of your coronary off, for sure. By the time you finish the anastomosis, you are almost dead. I've done almost 140 lap radical prostatectomies. Trust me, I won't go back and do it again. It is very painful to do that operation. Then the advent of robot came, and we had, we all know the excellent laparoscopic cholecystectomy. Now, laparoscopy is now available in every hospital. When people ask me, you're talking fancy things, it's not going to be available everywhere. The same people said that laparoscopy was a fancy thing in 1988 and 89. Now laparoscopy is available in every hospital. Similarly, I'm very sure robot will be available in every hospital in another 10 to 15 years time. So this is a modular laparoscopic theater. Some of the hospitals in India also have it. We used to have it in Germany as well as in my operating unit in Bradford. We used to do all surgeries laparoscopically. That is at least until 2009-10. That is one of the patients who had a lap radical prostatectomy by me. But we move on. We now have the MG Rover introduced back again. We have a Ferrari. So we are looking at Ferrari nowadays. But trust me, Ferrari will become available for every common man. That's the truth. In laparoscopy, we had a huge problem with learning curve. How to teach the other person. And the amount of time that you need to spend, especially in reconstructive laparoscopic surgery, is a lot of time that needs to be spent. especially those who are doing reconstructive surgery, such as CVD closure or gastric closure, using a needle and trying to suture a 3D structure and a 2D vision, will know that it is not going to be easy to do those stuff. What robot that did is to overcome all those deficiencies that the laparoscopy had. And also laparoscopic surgery is, I used to say, it's like operating with chopsticks. And perhaps that's the reason Chinese were very good in laparoscopic surgery. You see, the best surgeons in the world are Chinese or Japanese surgeons. They are very good at chopsticks. They can operate very quickly with chopsticks. But namala kai use pandrom illaya, we use hand. So probably robot is the one which we need, not the chopsticks. But definitely laparoscopy improved the stay, length of stay, shorten the length of stay, recovery of the patient, and pain scores were much better. So from that point, we moved to the Enviren robot. Not the Enviren that we see with Rajinikanth, but definitely something like this. So a standard laparoscopic set, the robot set will have these components. This is a surgeon and a console, we call surgeon console. This is called patient cart. You see, there are about four arms in the robotic patient cart, and this is the assistant cart, where the assistant can see what is being done inside the abdomen or whichever part you're operating. Why robot? Those surgeons who are sitting in this place will know that by the time you finish a laparoscopic surgery, you have a lot of fatigue in your hand, fatigue in your shoulder, the precision, because your mind is constantly converting a 2D into a 3D and a 3D into a 2D. You're seeing the screen to see a 2D and you're trying to do a 3D operation with the screen. So that constant conversion fatigues the mind as well a lot. Especially this is very valuable when you're trying to do suturing. Imagine trying to do a urethrovesical anastomosis, trying to see how the needle drives in. It's a challenge. It took my professor Schwarzenberg used to tell me, after you put 1,000 sutures in the lab, come into the theater. So when I went to train, I put 1,000 laparoscopic sutures in glove and tried to suture. The first suture took about 45 minutes to just put. By the time I finished 1,000, I was doing it about 30 second suture. So it takes an enormous drive of learning from the surgeon point of view to learn that and to execute it all the time. And when you are trying to execute, the assistant will not be able to cooperate with what you are doing. He will be having something else doing. So the camera will not be under your control, the assistant is not cooperating unless you have a really nice assistant. So by the time you finish a laparoscopy, I used to do only one laparoscopy a day. And by the time you finish, you are really tired. But robot changed all those stuff once and for all. Robot doesn't operate on its own. Let's be very clear on this. Robot doesn't do any operations. Of course, there is Google and Google Work. We call it Google Work. It's trying to simulate radical prostatectomy. They have taken about 100,000 videos. They are taking a lot of data points and seeing whether they can execute a robot doing an operation itself. So far, nobody is successful. I hope they are not successful at all. Otherwise, many of us will become jobless. But nonetheless, that's being tested by Google. Google seems to be a dangerous company to look nowadays. It's a master slave system. So what you do is what happens inside the abdomen, and it's a very simple. To put it this way, the youngsters who play BFIT and Xbox will do much better with the robot. They can just play very quickly, and they can understand that very quickly too. So this is, as I said, this is the Da Vinci robot. Sadly, we have only one robot in market today. It's called Da Vinci robot. It is marketed by Intuitive System. However, I recently went to States to test the next robot that is being launched into the system, called Medtronic's robot. Pavilion is presenting that. So we went and did the last set of testing. Hopefully by end of this year, we'll have Medtronic's robot being introduced to the market, and with that, the cost of the robotics will come down significantly. Whenever there's a competition, like Sir said, when the competition comes, everything gets slashed down. So with the advent of Medtronic robots, we're going to have a lot more cheaper robotic surgery available. So this is laparoscopy gives at the best of 7 times magnification. We get 12 times with robot. We have a 3D vision. and we have 7 degrees of freedom. What is the 7 degrees of freedom? Imagine ourselves, we have a movement at the elbow, the shoulder, the wrist, the hand, and finally the fingers. Similarly, robot will do all those steps. So even though it is operating at the level, it's almost like your hand operating there. And all those attachments will allow you to move almost like the robot inside. And there is something called scaling down. That is, let us say you're operating on a 1 centimeter point where you are operating. The whole movement of all the objects will scale down to that. Let us say you take your arms away and have a panoramic view. Everything scales up to adjust to the panoramic view that you're operating. The technology, the robotic technology that Da Vinci has given is extremely good. It is as good as it can get. And learning curve, I mean, it is almost takes about 4-5 surgeries for me to teach my junior as how to do this operation, which used to take almost, my teacher taught me laparoscopy, radical prostatectomy, over 60 operations, 60 surgeries he assisted me before I could do on my own. But the modern day, 10 surgeries max, the guy can do the surgery. In terms of patient benefit, early discharge to work. Nowadays, so the standard of care in my unit is that all are done as day care surgery, radical nephrectomy, pyeloplasty, everything is done as day case surgery, and we are trying to implement day case radical prostatectomy as well. We have brought it down to 24-hour discharge, that is patient gets admitted at 7 o'clock in the morning and discharges at 6 o'clock in the morning. So we have got it down to that level, so with the hopefully the next 10 cases we will get it down to a day case, admitted in the morning to go in the evening, day case radical prostatectomy. So the only thing that the patient stays back is partial nephrectomy because there is a reconstruction that goes on there, and cystectomy because there is a lot of bubble work that goes on as well. The rest all robotic surgery or day case, done in the morning, go in the evening. And the outcomes of robotic surgery is, there is only one which can match the outcome of robotic surgery, which is open surgery. If somebody tells me about laparoscopic surgery, I am very sorry to say that there is operation that will entail removal of an organ, such as nephrectomy or a cholecystectomy, is amazing with laparoscopy, that's fine. But when it comes to reconstruction, laparoscopy can never match open surgery. In terms of precision of suturing, the how much of tightness you put on the suture, those things can never match with open surgery. The only thing which will match is a robotic surgery. And that you see by the outcomes. In my laparoscopy radical prostatectomy, I've had at least 2 patients who had radical stenosis, probably because of too much of tight suturing. Here in robot, I've never had one patient as well. So that is the change that you see in terms of outcomes. I don't even remember when I ever transfused blood for radical prostatectomy the last 8 years, maybe one I've given. Complication, so far, touch wood, I've not had any complications with robotic surgery at all. The standard complication with any surgery, such as mild IDS, can happen with robotic surgery as well. Nothing related to the robot itself or the minimally invasive technique. In the laparoscopic radical prostatectomy days, I used to have catheter for 14 days. Nowadays, the standard, I have the catheter only for 7th day. 7th day patients get catheter removed as well. And back to work. 46-year-old male gets a radical prostatectomy, is back to work by day 14 in his office, working full time. That is the joy of robotics. These are the components of robot. I've just gone through that. And these are the instruments. What you are seeing, this is just about 78 millimeter in length. That's all the instrument size. So we have a 3D vision. We have endorheus movement. As you can see, it moves at all parts of itself. And we have an intuitive motion. This is what I said about scaling. It adjusts itself to the point where you are seeing. It readjusts itself to that. And in Jibber, where I met my mentor, the first robotic surgery in the Gama setup was Jibber, after PJ Chandigarh. So I went to mentor those people to get going with the robotics, and they are doing extremely well now. And we have a dual console where I could sit in one console and train the surgeon in the other console. So that is also available with the robot. We have a lot of advantages with robot. I mean, you can see type pro, what we call, I mean, you can see the tumor and mark the tumor at the same time. And there is something called firefly technique where you see the vascularity. So those are big advantages of robot, which is not there in laparoscope at all. And this is called fluorescence. That's what I said about firefly technique. That is, you inject the endocarmine and see how the vascularity is, and to determine how, whether, especially when you're doing the ideal conduit diversion, you want to see the tip of the ureter, whether they are vascular enough for you to do the anastomosis. So these techniques are available in robot, which is not available in laparoscope. So in urology, what are we doing with robot? We do everything with the robot, sadly. I'll just go through this quickly because I want to show a video which will be a much better demonstration of these things. By the way, robot was initially invented for heart, and we have, but sadly never took on for heart. Now we have started doing robot assisted CABG. I mentored my colleague Dr. Yusuf. We have started doing robot assisted CABG where Lima is being burnt out of the robot, and with just a 1 cm incision they do the anastomosis and finish the operation with a 1 day stay in the hospital. I'm going through these things because we have already gone through it. I want to come and show the video. So the prostate cancer robotics is the biggest thing in the world. As in, probably I would say 3/4 of the whole robotic surgery is on prostate cancer. So we have an excellent preservation of neurovascular bundle in robotics, which you cannot achieve with laparoscopy, and very difficult to achieve with open surgery as well. Better DVC control, as I said, I've not even transfused for almost, I do not know, across a few hundred robotic prostatectomies now. The outcomes are exactly the same. In renal cancer, this is my patient, which for the video, I'll show the video in a second. We can do robot. Can you imagine that patient having robotic partial nephrectomy and the kidney being preserved? That is the joy of robotics. So I'm going to move quickly because this is all technical thing. Yes. What is well established in robotics? As I said, urology, everything: pyloplasty, urinary clean plant, partial, total, IVC thrombus, name it, you get it. You get everything in robot. The open robot to open conversion I sadly done once for a what I thought was an RCC but turned out to be a sarcoma kidney, which I couldn't complete the operation, so I have to open and finish the operation. Other than that, everything is done with the robot. A gynae hysterectomy, lymph node dissection, name it, you get it. Incontinence procedure, Dr. Meera does a lot of sacropalpopexy as well. Pediatric surgery, Dr. Shripad is doing a lot of pyloplasty, ureteric reimplant. Nowadays he started doing microphenol as well with robot. Colorectal surgery, superbly well established in robot. Cardiac surgery, we have taken up. Head and neck toss is being done with the robot. Plastics, and they have not touched it there. And bariatrics, they do a lot of bariatrics with the robot. So robot has now almost come into every domain of surgery that you can ever think about. Future, we have a single port system. That is, you put one port and operate, do the whole operation with one port. I do not know the benefit of it. I have tried it, but I thought it was not, it didn't add any advantage to the existing system. Then we have a newer robot, Perseus robot from Cambridge, and Medtronic's robot is also there. That's what I said, I was involved in the Medtronic robot, and very likely they will be launching now. So with that, I'm going to stop my talk here, and I'm going to, somebody asked me, can robot replace a human? Never, at least not in my future, probably I'll be dead by then. I don't think a robot can ever replace a human. Google Verb is trying to replicate some bits of radical prostatectomy using the data points, but they have not got into that yet. It will still remain a master slave system, and I'm very happy that way as well. Cost, there is definitely a cost to the robotics as much as we have done, particularly myself. I worked with the hospital management to reduce the cost. To that level, I said that it should be only 20,000 more than open surgery. That's how I price it now. But that, for that, I fought a lot. And some of the management staff are behind me. They're smiling quietly. But we are doing our best to make the robot being accessible to the common public. That's what I'm trying to do. Robots will stay. And as I told, mark my words, in 10 years' time, many of the hospitals will have robots, will be there. And almost every surgical branch will start using robot as well. Can I just, if you don't mind, go to the video? And when the video is running, I'll just give an introduction and then I'm free to take questions. The video is just to show the joy of robotics, that's all. So there's no audio to it. It's a 23-year-old who came from Coimbatore with an intra-renal tumor picked up from a mast cell checkup. He was getting married, so he had a mast cell checkup. They found a tumor, and therefore he came to me. Well, he was told to have a radical nephrectomy in Coimbatore, but he said, can you preserve my kidney? That's the question. I said, okay, we'll take a challenge. We'll see whether we can preserve the kidney. Of course, I didn't tell him that I didn't promise him that I would do it. I said we will try. So this particular operation, we call it. There is two ways of doing it. We can do an anatropic nephrectomy. That is, you cut alongside the lateral aspect of the kidney, go into the tumor and take it out. But that involves almost the whole kidney bivalve. So I devised a new system by which. You take a small disc of the renal cortex, take a tumor, and then suture everything back again. And that was presented in the International Robotic Forum as a very novel pioneering technique. And that has become the standard for almost all intrarenal partition that is done across the world now. So, that is the renal artery and vein being displayed there. Absolutely fine. He came in Times Now edition. He came talking about this. He is now what? 5-6 years now? He has two children. RCC? D1. RCC, if you are a low grade RCC, you are almost cured. Thankfully, he had a grade 1 RCC, permanent grade 1 RCC. So practically, he is cured. Practically.
You can take the ureter and put a reimplant on that.
So you need to cut the ureter and reimplant in another place. You cannot reimplant in the same place. So it is just it will be useful if you. So those sort of surgeries will be applicable if you think there is a longevity to the patient. The patient is going to live for, let us say, 1 to 2 years. Attempting to do the surgery will give the benefit. If the patient is going to live for only a few months, cost and the effort is not worth it. So this is called Tai Pro, where we are seeing real time using the intraoperative ultrasound and marking the tumor using the same thing. And that what I've done is the tumor was about 3.5 centimeters. I cut a disc of about 1 to 1.5 centimeters, went in and did the surgery, came back and closed the disc back again. Something like that. Otherwise, bivalving the whole kidney means there is a serious compromise, the vascularity. So, we just sat and thought through it and did it, but it became the standard of care now for many of the intrarenal partials. And after this, after I presented, many of the people have started doing the intrarenal effect. Previously, these patients used to get only nephrectomy because how to go in and take it out. But now a lot of centers are doing intrarenal partials. WIMS may not be possible now because WIMS involves the whole kidney. Sadly, the whole kidney has to go. But if you have bilateral WIMS, then you can do a chemotherapy, downsize it, and then do a bilateral partial. That is doable. So that kidney is now white because we have clamped the artery and vein. We now have about 30 minutes to work. So once the artery is clamped and vein is clamped, we have about 30 minutes to work to finish the operation. After 30, max 40 minutes, the kidney's survival starts to come down. So this is a surgery which classically is race against time. We need to work within that span to finish the operation and unclamp the kidney, unclamp the artery off. Just there is the main axial artery on the right side. Can you see that? The white structure there, which is, it's a tumor out. So, if I would have to injure that artery, the kidney is lost. So, the joy of robotics is that you can preserve all these fine structures and yet remove what is to be removed. That precision surgery is because of the articulated instruments that you get. And the 3D vision, which is very difficult to replicate in a 2D vision.
In robotic surgery, is there a component of laparoscopy also there?
For assisted is a laparoscopy because he is only having a 2D vision. For the surgeon, it's a 3D vision. For the assisted, he is seeing a 2D monitor. Only the surgeon gets the benefit of 3D. The assisted 3D is also coming now. We anticipate that in a few years, it's available in the market. But because the assisted role is actually limited in robotics, other than sucking and supplying whatever is to be supplied, the surgery is done by the surgeon. It's almost a one-man army there.
The vision is through the robot.
Vision is through the surgeon console. You have the binocular vision inside. The XI machine is about 16 crores. But I am very sure once the Medtronics come down, it will very significantly come down. Yes, sir?
Yes, sir. Very nice description.
Nicely
projected.
Thank you, sir.
Happy that you are from.
I am a student as well.
That's what I was telling. I could not recognize it. Now, will you accept if I say that breadwinning surgery for urologists is most effective? Has gone down after introduction of alpha blockers. Now, what is that in the real people? When we start on alpha blockers, the hypertrophy reduces. And now, what is the real indication for prostatectomy when they are on alpha blockers?
Sir, the surgeries that you see is for cancer. So, alpha blocker is for benign disease. The radical prostatectomy which we do is for prostate cancer. So, when I say prostatectomy, I'm talking about prostate cancer. In terms of benign disease, alpha blocker has postponed surgery. We thought alpha blocker will eliminate surgery, which sadly it didn't. So, what happened is, with the advent of alpha blocker, the surgery time from say zero has moved by about 7 years. And we are getting larger prostates than what we used to get before. As a trainee, I used to do a 30 gram prostate often. But with the advent of alpha blocker and widespread abuse of alpha blocker, we are getting more and more 70 gram prostate to resect when they eventually come to have the surgery, the benign surgery as well. Even in benign surgery, if the prostate size is more than 100 gram, I do a Millen's prostatectomy with a robot, with one day stay, that is a day case operation. Come in the morning, go in the night, Millen's prostatectomy with no blood loss. We have a series as well.
When
you are
doing this robotic surgery, by mistake, if you touch a vein or artery, will it caution you? The machine will it caution?
Machine doesn't caution. You caution yourself.
So only in while typewriting the Google, it caution. This spelling mistake and all that doesn't do anything.
No. The autocorrect has not come. Sadly, in robotics, thankfully. Because if I really don't think so, Google should come into robotics because they will start autocorrecting what I'm doing, and that is very dangerous. The master-slave system is the best way to do robotics. Master-slave system is still, because the surgeon is still in control of the events. What it has done is eliminated the tremors. Which when you are using a laparoscope, if your hand is tremoring, the tremor will not be transmitted into the patient. The tremor elimination has happened with the robot, but not the muscle. It's still a muscle slave system. It does what you ask it to do. If you move your hand, it moves inside. If you stop, it stops. That's what it does.
So just a question: in your radical prostate development, has there been any controlled studies comparing open surgery with robot? Is there any debate at all? It's totally
non-controversial. If you come into my world, that is the most controversial topic as well. I have my own personal series of open RAP and robots prostatectomy. I still do a lot of open prostatectomy. I still do open radical prostatectomy. I'm still one of those rare breed of surgeons who has done open radical prostatectomy. I used to tell my juniors, after my generation, nobody has seen open radical prostatectomy. Sadly, because in America, everything is converted into robot. So nobody does open radical prostatectomy. I still do because of cost. In terms of recovery, if you see the 3 months data, there is no difference between the two. Open and robot does the same, lab does inferior. The 3 month data. But if you look at the 1 week data, 6 weeks data, robot is superior to the open. Because there is no cut, no scar, no recovery. They can practice the pelvic floor exercise much better. They're back to work. So if you look at the overall scheme of things, by 3 months, no difference is there. So the people who support robot will always look at the 6 weeks data. People who support open will always look at the 3 month data. The way you see only matters.
So it's not totally non-controversial.
Hugely controversial. Hugely controversial. The people against robot think, why are you wasting time? But trust me, to learn open radical prostatectomy, to teach somebody that takes enormous hit on the coronaries. As I always say, you need about 50 open radical prostatectomy for you to master that. And then imagine I need to train my junior with another 50 to train him on, and the generation after. It's a huge task. I was lucky by, at that time, open radical prostatectomy was the norm in UK. When I learned it. But now even in UK, robotic radical prostatectomy is the norm. How to train people? The next generation students don't know how to do open radical prostatectomy. The dead art. You can manage very easily with the robots. I have done IVC thrombectomy. You can manage very, very easily. You have 3 arms, and then you have control. You can easily hold the thing, take a suture and suture it. It's about 3.5 lakhs, 3.2 to 3.5 lakhs for a general ward patient. Open will be about 2.7 because open, the length of stay is longer. Length of stay is longer. So the robot, the length of stay is shorter. So it's about 30,000 rupees to 40,000 rupees. In terms of machine failure, so far out of about 1 million+ procedures, 1,000 machine failures have happened. I had a machine failure where the camera, the light source went off. So I attached a laparoscopic light source and finished the operation. As I said, I have converted one case. Where it was a leiomyosarcoma kidney, we thought it was an RCC and went in. The dissecting planes were so difficult and the tumor was about 23 centimeters in size. So I had to eventually convert that. So I have done a lot of what we call large renal tumors, 17+ centimeters a lot. It comes easy with the robot because there's no blood loss there. I did an ophthalmologist with a hemoglobin of 8 and finished with a hemoglobin of 8. After surgery. So that is doable with the robot. But in this case, because of the sarcoma component, it was not, the dissection was difficult. So I converted. That's the only condition.
So,
open
face and robotic.
A cystoscope they put it now. But if you do laparoscopic, robotic pyeloplasty, you can put the stent from the top as well.
Open
face
and a robotic, any surgery, just for example, some example. Say, what will be the time difference?
If you, when you start robotics, the robotics will be slightly longer, obviously. But once you cross the learning curves, it will be same.
How long?
For me, in my hand, radical prostatectomy, if I divide the radical prostatectomy and lymphadenectomy as two different components, radical prostatectomy with anastomosis takes about 1 hour 40 minutes, and lymphadenectomy takes about another 40 minutes to 30 minutes. It's same in both sides. I do extraperitoneal radical prostatectomy, which means literally you're not entering the peritoneal cavity at all. But that will take another 15 minutes extra for the porting. About 30 to 40 thousand rupees difference between open and robot. In full terms, I'm talking true cost. I always talk general ward because Apollo has different tariffs. So general ward patient for an open radical prostatectomy will be about 2.8 to 3 lakhs. Robot is 3.5. We have packaged it to 3.5. Yeah. Amazing, amazing. Dr. Srimati has wonderful work. He does lots of pyeloplasties, ureteric reimplants, robotic, yeah. And microphonography. He is doing a fantastic work in periodic urology across the world as well. The youngest baby I think has done is about 5 months, is what I was told. He does amazing work. A pyeloplasty.
Even
VUR, yeah. Reimplants, yeah. Reimplants can be done. There are about 70 robots so far, and if you take the surgeons, there are about 130 to 150 urology, and if you take colorectal and other surgeons all inclusive, it touches about 400. So in Chennai, we have now 3 robots. We have about 10, 11 surgeons. Yeah. I thank the organizers and the people for patiently receiving. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure. And it's amazing pleasure to see my teachers, Dr. Srinivas and Dr. Lekha. It's amazing to stand in this crowd. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Next we move on.